thank you all for coming here tonight. Slowly still have a few people coming in, but I'm going to go ahead and start with the introduction and get started. Mike has agreed once again very gracefully to join us tonight to share his take on the natural regions of Indiana. Mike Homoya served as botanist and plant ecologist for the Indiana Department of Natural Resources Division of Nature Preserves for 37 years before retiring in 2019. He has written over 75 scientific papers, popular articles, and books about Indiana's natural features, including orchids of Indiana, wildflowers, and ferns of Indiana forests, a field guide, Wake Up Woods, and Wildflowers of the Midwest, which is impressed. He is a board member and past president of the Indiana Native Plant Society. Again, Mike, thanks again for being here tonight.
Well, thank you. You
take it from here.
Thank you, Brooke. I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. And good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm pleased that you've taken some time out of your day, since there's still some daylight out and we could be out in the field, but maybe it's a little too hot and muggy, as they say on Muggly. I've heard some of the newscasters say. Title of the presentation, Natural Regions of Indiana. There's more than corn in Indiana. Although you ask a lot of people, especially those that just are passed through the state people, drive the interstates, might think that that's all we have. But I hope this evening to show you, although you may not be needing convinced that that's not true, that we do have something more than corn in Indiana. And when you think about Indiana, a lot of people think not only of our agricultural activities, but actually think of us as part of an ecoregion and call us the Corn Belt Plain ecoregion. To me, that's an oxymoron. I cannot for the life of me understand why someone who put this map together felt that plains of corn would be an ecoregion, a natural region for the Midwest, but indeed that's what apparently this person did that put this map together. What else do people think of when they think of Indiana? Well, this is what they think of. Of course, the Indianapolis 500, of which we just concluded here recently. So it's a big deal. A lot of people around the world know about the Indianapolis 500. So you have to think about that. You have to talk about that when talking about Indiana. But many people don't realize that there are some spectacular natural areas that still remain in Indiana, such as this Clifty Falls Nature Preserve, which is located within Clifty Falls State Park in Jefferson County near the town of Madison in southeastern Indiana. And Rocky Hollow Nature Preserve, which is in Turkey Run State Park, has some magnificent waterfalls and sandstone canyons. Just truly impressive landscape, especially in central Indiana, which for the most part is relatively flat. We also are the home of big trees, or at least we used to be. We have some fabulous soils in Indiana that did historically grow very large trees, especially the one that you see with the two gentlemen at the right of your screen. That is a large sycamore tree down in the lower Wabash Valley, where a lot of species of trees attained significant girth and height. This is famed Charles Deem, author of Flora of Indiana and many other works back in the early 1900s, next to a bur oak tree up in northeastern Indiana. Look at the size of that tree. But we're not going to just talk about corn. We're going to take a little trip. drive around the state, look at the natural beauty of Indiana. I'm hoping to convince you that we're wilder.
Get your motor running.
Let's proceed. You know, I made that slide for another presentation that perhaps you've seen, but you know, it took me a while to put that thing together, and so I figured I need to find another way to show it again, so I'm showing it to you this evening. And that is not my bike, by the way.
Thanks, Mike. That was awesome.
So here's a natural regions map of Indiana that some co-workers and myself wrote an article about the natural regions of Indiana back in 1985. And this is the map that accompanies the text, which is published in the Indiana Academy of Science. We identified 12 natural regions. And some, as you can see, are relatively small. Some are quite large. We're not going to go through each and every one of them. We'd be here for a while. They're divided up into sections on this map, and we'll very briefly talk about a few of the sections, but we'll cover every part of the state. In general, I like to think of Indiana's ecological mashup. That is, the biota or the flora and fauna of our continent all seem to nicely mix and meld in the Midwest, and especially in Indiana. And you can see on the right hand of your screen, that's the eastern, to represent the eastern deciduous forest. The far north, northeast in particular, is where the northern affinities come into play. The west, the northwest part of the state, is where the tall grass prairie comes in a significant way into Indiana. And then in the south, I'm showing there bald cypress, which is at the northern limit of its range, natural range, especially as a natural community in Indiana, but there are also a lot of non-wetland sites in southern Indiana. In fact, some of our most rugged and hilly country is in the south. This slide is, of course, just text, but I like it. It says the plant world exists by geological consent. Of course, there are a lot of things that are involved in what gets expressed as vegetation in Indiana. It's very complicated, from soils, precipitation, slope, if you're in, of course, you're either level or on a hill, and what aspect of that hill you are. The climate, of course, lots of different things come into play, but the geology is, in my estimation, particularly significant. And you know, Indiana was a state that was, for the most part, glaciated, and there were several glacial advances of a large ice sheet that in some cases were thought to be a mile thick. If that's not impressive, just imagine that. And down 2 feet. And here's a map showing the extent of the continental glaciation from recorded from thousands of years ago. Green. As you can see, it's the extent of glacial deposits. And this portion of Indiana in the dark green is that area which is unglaciated. That's where our rugged hill country is. And we'll be talking about that rugged hill country. Here's a little finer detailed map. And you can see that area that I just showed you earlier, that was considered unglaciated, is within this orange line. So this is all unglaciated territory. It's not the only glacier that had played a significant role in Indiana's landscape. This line here is the Wisconsin glacial limit. And north of that, the landscape in Indiana is relatively level, with some exceptions, again, that we'll talk about. Glacier is significant, especially in terms of soils as well. Those areas north of this glacial border are generally not particularly acidic. In fact, oftentimes they're either basic in pH or alkaline, whereas south of that line, the soils are typically acidic. And again, there are exceptions to all of this. There are areas in the sand country of northwest Indiana that are very acidic. But for the most part, north of that line will have alkaline or basic soils, and south they'll be acidic. And that plays a significant role in distribution of plants and animals in Indiana. A couple of maps showing bedrock geology. If you were to scrape off the veneer of soil from the upper limit of our soils in Indiana, you would see these areas of bedrock, different ages. And for instance, over here in the green to the southwest is Pennsylvanian sandstone. And then you go east and you get mostly limestone with some sandstone. And then it just goes on through all the different strata of bedrock. And in places, these crop out. Even along the Wabash River in northern Indiana, there are a few areas where limestone crops out, and plants, that especially those that are obligate to growing on cliffs, could be found. And this is our surface. It may be hard to get a depth of field there, but look at all what is attempting to show erosion and deep ravines and cutting of streams and so forth. And therefore, this is a much more landscape. So back to this natural regions map. This area we're going to talk about first, this is what we identified as the bluegrass natural regions. Hilly over here on the far eastern edge of it, very flat west of that. These are areas of acidic flat woods. The soils are acidic, poorly drained, and then you get floodplain down along the Muscatatuck River. But along the Ohio River, there are places that are deeply incised, and you get things like the Clifty Falls there near Madison, Indiana. And some of the stream cutting, this is Big Creek in Jefferson County, where there's cutting through the limestone. And in places, there are hills where there are even pockets of prairie vegetation. That's extremely rare in southeastern Indiana. This is a creek here. This is in Versailles State Park over in Ripley County. And this is one of these hills that we call a slump bluff. It has a little bit of rock and shale in it, and it's very unstable as a consequence. And by being so unstable and steep, trees don't grow quite as well, but prairie vegetation does. You see a lot of the grasses there, big Indian grass. Just to show you the eastern influence in that part of the state, this is a lily. It looks a lot like our wild Michigan lily that occurs throughout Indiana, but this is the Canada lily, and the blue shows the outline of an area of extent of occurrence of that species, and it barely gets into Indiana. I mentioned that there are extensive areas of flatwoods in that area, and that's what's trying to be shown here. Has a lot of beech, some sugar maples, pin oak if it's very wet, such as this, swamp white oak, even some swamp chestnut oak. It's a very level landscape, and therefore we call it flat woods, not too scientific there, but accurate. I'm gonna move west. This, I'm going to be talking about two different natural regions, the Highland Rim Natural Region and the Shawnee Hills. The Highland Rim is in blue, shades of blue, and then the green there, 9A and 9B, that's the Shawnee Hills. There's predominantly sandstone. This is where we had a number of travelers and explorers come through Indiana, would depart the Ohio River at the Falls of the Ohio near for us in Indiana, it would be Clarksville and New Albany, and travel across that hilly landscape to Vincennes. Vincennes was a station back in the early 1800s. And this is what one of the travelers, Prince Maximilian, said, as perhaps you've had a chance to read. He's never before seen such forests in North America, just magnificent, extensive forests that Indiana could claim. There's still a fair bit of forest land in southern Indiana. And if you look here, you can see especially where there's a huge block of more or less contiguous timber. And that's at the north end of those two natural regions, the Highland Rim and the Shawnee Hills. Two trees in particular are quite prominent. Tulip tree, and you can see the range there in green, and almost corresponding in range with it is the American beech, also an important tree in the landscape of our eastern deciduous forests. So you can see how and what I mean about we're sort of in that mashup where the east will meet the west. Down in the Shawnee Hills, we have some significant sandstone outcrops and deep ravines. And those are really cool places for a number of rare and uncommon species. Those soils you would consider moist, whereas if you go on the higher slopes, especially if they're south facing, it will become much drier, and as the soils are, and therefore the vegetation is of such that corresponds with those species that can tolerate or grow in dry soil, such as these chestnut oak and white oaks that you see in this scene. Those are two pretty dominant species of trees on the drier slopes in those natural regions. And this is an understory of them, of those areas, which is pretty typical. You get the low bush blueberry, which was a Vaccinium pallidum, and black huckleberry and leaved greenbrier. If you've ever gotten off a trail in those hills and knobs down in southern Indiana, you might be cursing the presence of that greenbrier, because it can form quite a tangle and can be pretty difficult to navigate. And perhaps you recognize what this map might represent. Maybe you've seen it in print or even on television, but we are the home, especially in the southern part of the state, for brood 10 periodical cicadas. If you haven't been to southern Indiana, I think there's still time to get down and see those en masse. Tens of thousands, millions, and billions, perhaps. Okay, on our travel tour, I can say I have had the fortune to travel around in the state a fair bit. I'm going to throw just a few little oddities of things, just for they don't have anything to do with natural regions. But I figure this must be the smallest town in Indiana. This is out in southern Indiana. You are entering and leaving Gatesville. So I'm thinking it must just exist as a single line. And if you're in the business for purchasing trees, in some places you can buy half trees. In this case, acers being the genus name for maple. But this person happened to have 14 and a half of them for sale. Okay, we're really going to get down in a rugged part of the state now. This is not far from the Ohio River. And you've perhaps heard me talk before, if you've heard me speak more than once, perhaps, and it's hard to believe I never mentioned this, but I am a big fan of the pre-settlement vegetation notes, those notes that were made by the early surveyors prior to any significant settlement of Indiana. And they would survey section lines of the state and would describe what the land was like. And this particular area is in the Hoosier National Forest down in Perry County. You can see the star here about where this is. And these are the lines that those surveyors would travel. They are the ones who made the lines in essence. You know, they're not lines that you can see on the ground. They're survey lines, but they reference them from points that they make where the lines intersect. And land purchases today and descriptions are still based on what they did. But look what, in this particular case, let's smile, poor shrub oak hills, stony soils, poor barren grassy hills, much flintstone shrub oaks. This mile, first part, poor grassy hills, better towards the east end. So in this case, you knew that they were traveling this line, and in this one, they were going such, and I happen to know from their notes that they were traveling from here to the north. And I put a star here because I wanted to see if what exists today still matches with what they wrote. And I was able more or less to find this point using a topographic map and compass, and went there. And sure enough, to my amazement and delight, that landscape still looks pretty much like they described over 200 years ago. Most of these trees are post oak with some scattered black jack oak. And there are the grasses. There are this big blue stem there, for instance. And there's little blue stem Indian grass. It's just a magical place, especially for southern Indiana. One thing that those notes are also good for is to tell you what sort of tree dominance were in the area. Most people think that everything, especially in southern Indiana, and a lot of it, but here those notes showed us the sugar maple and beech were significant trees. And these are trees that they marked and diameters that they marked along their section lines. One interesting feature that's very uncommon in southern Indiana and Indiana for that matter, we refer to as limestone glades. It's where there is naturally hardly any soil on these slopes. Rock is right at the surface, just enough soil to grow vegetation. And that vegetation has much in common with our prairies to the west. And you can see there's a lot of little blue stem, for instance, there. And a myriad of very beautiful wildflowers, such as this obedient plant that you can see here, the Physostigia. And there's a liatris, that's liatris asper, the blazing star that's just getting ready to start blooming. And near those glades, you can find a native orchid, one of my favorites, called crested coral root orchid, Hexalectris spicata. Has no chlorophyll, therefore it in many respects is like a fungus, except in this case, this is a true flowering vascular plant. It gets its nutrition from green plants via a conduit of fungal strands. So it's pretty interesting cycle. But it is indeed a true orchid. You can also find this critter down in those southern Indiana hills. It's not, of course, as big as it'll look on your screen, but it's pretty sizable for an Indiana spider, at least so stocky looking, and one that looks so much like a tarantula. It was a pretty scary looking spider, but a really interesting one in the southern Indiana hills. Many people don't realize how important Indiana is with regard to rarity. Hot spots, as you can see in the real orange coloration here, shows a sizable area there in Indiana has having critically imperiled species on a global scale. So southern Indiana is very important. Indeed, we are more than corn and beans. And most of those species that are extremely rare occur in the karst country where there are a number of caves and sinkholes. This is Donaldson Cave Nature Preserve down in Spring Mill State Park. And these are some of the species not necessarily found in Donaldson's cave, but in some other caves. And they make up some of the rare species that we have in Indiana. In some cases, known only from a particular single site. There's also very rare plants there in southern Indiana. This is a limestone shelves that go down to the Blue River. And you may, if you're lucky, to find this plant called Short's Goldenrod. It's named after its discoverer, Charles Short, a botanist and physician in Kentucky, who found it at the Falls of the Ohio, there in the Louisville, Clarksville area. He found it in 1840. In 1939, Lucy Brown found a single population in Northeast Kentucky. And then we were fortunate to find a population in 2001. And that is the extent of its known occurrence ever. It still exists at this site in Eastern Kentucky, but not any longer at the Falls of the Ohio. So there are only two places in the world where you can see that goldenrod. Only one place in the world, and that is in Indiana, more than one site in Indiana, but you have to see it in Indiana, called Deems Foxglove, named after him, the discoverer, and our great pioneer botanist, Charles Deem. If you watched my presentation I gave last time on ferns of Indiana, you might recognize this site, and in particular here, it's of a plant that lives back down in the recesses. This is the scene, the view from that plant, let's say, looking out towards the forest, surrounding forest. So you get an idea that it's pretty dark environment, but yet it thrives. And it's this, the Appalachian filmy fern. One cell layer thick. It's a family of plants that are mostly tropical with a few rare exceptions. And it can only live here because it's in those protected recesses under those sandstone overhangs. Another plant that likes those overhangs is also fairly rare in Indiana, but not as rare as the filmy fern. This is French's shooting star, not to be confused with our common shooting star that is rather widespread within Indiana. This one's just restricted to occurring under the overhangs of sandstone or on the ledges of sandstone in deep southern Indiana. Further west, where the landscape is not as hilly, in fact, quite a bit of it's fairly flat, but the bottomlands, the floodplain forests, were magnificent. And Robert Ridgway was fortunate, we were fortunate to have him do studies on the lower Wabash. And as you can see here, he says that deep soil nourishes trees of astonishing dimensions. And we looked at some of those pictures. In fact, that's him, Robert Ridgway, there and there. And he measured some of the trees. Now, these are diameters, not circumference around. Pretty sizable trees. these, you know, here's a 10 foot diameter. Here's a tulip tree that's 7 feet in diameter. Big trees. There's a Quercus alba and Macrocarpa white oak, bur oak, American elms, trees of all species of large dimensions. And of course, to me, the real signature species of Southwest Indiana is the bald cypress, naturally occurring. The dark blue is the natural range of where it occurs. And as you can see, we're at certainly the most farthest north in occurrence in the Midwest of that species, natural occurrence. And as especially as it occurs in a natural community. Twin Swamps Nature Preserve is where that slide was taken. Just put a pitch in for that. If you've not ever been there, that's a must see. Twin Swamps Nature Preserve. You can look that one up, and it's a place you need to go. This is our largest natural region, the Central Till Plain. And we'll talk about this all collectively, except for a part of it. Lots of flat land, and of course that made it amenable to clearing, which ultimately became most of our corn and bean lands in Indiana. This is a little remnant though, it still exists. This is Burnett Woods Nature Preserve in Hendricks County near the town of Avon. And some of it's quite wet as well, just like those flat woods we looked at Southeast Indiana. So we have these sort of depressional wetlands, and the difference in elevation may only be a few inches. Not much of this left, of course, a lot of it's been drained and especially after it's been cleared. Pretty important. I have an arrow here pointing to what I call the entrenched valley section of the Central Till Plain. Unlike the rest of the Till Plain, this has some pretty to Shade State Park or Turkey Run State Park, such as what you see here, that's Sugar Creek flowing through it. You know what I mean, that it is quite rugged. It's entrenched down in the landscape. And there is where you can find one of our rarer trees, the Eastern Hemlock. And you can see the range of that species here in green, with scattered dots within Indiana. And right there, if you can see my pointer, that is Sugar Creek area. Just a beautiful, beautiful place. Okay, back on the road, Mount Healthy Cemetery. That seems a little odd to me, doesn't it, you? This is not Photoshop, this is real, but I used a flash and that in sunshine up, but I would say. I can see for miles and miles and miles. If you're back from my generation, of course, you know about the Who. What are they seeing for miles and miles? Well, in Indiana, you would be in this area just outlined, the Grand Prairie. That is an area where for many miles you could have walked for tens of miles without seeing a tree. It would have been a mix of grasses and prairie herbs or forage that just had to have been just a magnificent sight to see. And that is depicted here in black. Those survey notes that the surveyors took that we talked about earlier, that's how this could be as accurately mapped as it is. And that's the Grand Prairie area in black. And this is a slide of a remnant prairie in northern Indiana. And can you imagine walking through this just mile after mile? A more beautiful garden there just couldn't be. But most of it's gone, unfortunately. Kankakee Marsh was certainly a significant area. It consisted of expanses of marsh. And as one early French explorer noted in 1679, as far as the eye could reach, nothing was to be seen but marshes. Each one of these squares that I am outlining is a square mile. And all those little hash marks there represent marsh. The Kankakee River is just at the top of the screen here. So you can see this was a huge, huge area of marsh. Some people referred to it since as the Everglades of the North. Here's a photo of a topographic map of one of the remnants. This is a Jasper Plaski State Fish and Wildlife Area. And the open areas here in white with the bluish hash marks, those are marshlands. There you can see that an aerial photo of the same area showing up here as just water. But this is what it looks like on the ground in the summertime with all sorts of sedges and rushes, grasses and flowering plants. There are sundews in there, you know, the little carnivorous plant, bladderworts, and many, many rare plants. And interestingly, many of them have affinities to the Gulf coastal plain. They occur here in this area, and then you would have to jump almost all the way down to the coastal plain of the Gulf or maybe Southeast Atlantic coastal plain to find these species again. So it's truly a magnificent and unusual landscape. There's a scene of some of them. Here's Rexia, or the meadow beauty it's called, and the yellow-eyed grass, the Xyris. Uncommon plants in Indiana. And here's one of the bladderworts. It's carnivorous. It has little bladders that trap tiny little, oftentimes maybe just a little swimming crustacea or who knows what. But you can see the bladders on there barely. They're in the water. And they, like I say, they'll trap little animals. And this is a floating bladderwort, Utricularia radiata. And it's definitely one of the rarest, if not the rarest species of bladderwort in Indiana. There are other species. This is the only one that looks like this. This is the Northern Lakes. And this is really the most prominent feature in the Indiana landscape that was left to us by the retreating glacier. And it's an area where there are numerous natural lakes of various depths. Here on this map, it looks like there's one, so at least Dallas Lake here looks like it's about 100 feet deep. And there are others that exceed that, I suspect. And marshlands, wetlands. You know, they've been adulterated over the years. You know, the landscape around them has been cleared and all that runoff has to go somewhere, so it goes into the lakes. And many of them, the levels have been altered themselves and the marshlands that occurred around them. But fortunately, we still have some nice examples of natural lakes. This is one of the Nature Conservancy preserves up north, showing a typical scene of what one of the margins of the lakes would look like. Very marshy. And their community, natural communities called fens, where groundwater will just ooze into the soil surface. Here it's doing it in what's called a marly area, and very, very alkaline. But it's there you find interesting plants, not in the marl so much, but out in on the edge of a fen, snowy lady slipper, Indiana's largest native orchid. Trilliums, these are not in the fens, but up on the mesic uplands. Large flowered trillium puts on quite a show in the spring in northern Indiana for the most part, in some cases down south. Then there are bogs where floating mats of sphagnum moss are perched above water, and loving plants in particular occur in them. This one isn't necessarily acid loving, but it's perfectly happy there. This is another one of our carnivorous plants, the northern pitcher plant. You know, those are the ones whose leaves are modified as vessels that hold water and in which insects and various other critters can get trapped and ultimately digested by those plants. So it is a carnivore. There's another view up more closely. You can see the water there and these downward pointing hairs that are an impediment to any insect or other critter trying to crawl and get up out of there. And here's a sphagnum moss. If you know what peat is, like peat moss, not peat like what you'd buy as a bag of peat usually, but as peat moss, it's different. Peat that you'd purchase is often just made up of organic decayed sedges and grasses, but this is the sphagnum moss, a true moss, which is dried and baled as sphagnum peat. And last but not least is the area in far northwest Indiana, and especially the area that includes our dunes. Indiana Dunes State Park and now Indiana Dunes National Park, that border Lake Michigan. What a fantastic area that is. I want to point out rolling dune landscape, but notice the trees, the pine trees, and there's some there on that ridge top as well. Here's a big blowout of sand. Those are jack pine, and that's a northern species. And what we lay claim to is that Indiana has the southernmost natural occurrence of jack pine. So pretty cool. Notice that band of green that comes down along the east side and to the south of Lake Michigan. That is a corridor for a number of other northern plants that make their way down bordering the Lake Michigan and into Indiana. It's one of the nature preserves, State Park, Dune State Park. Fortunately, most all of the state park is a dedicated nature preserve. It's still state park, but it's dedicated. So it's has very limited activity with regard, especially with regard to placement of structures. And that, we have reached our destination. We started south down along the Ohio River. We've zigzagged our way north up to Lake Michigan to the end of our story. And so with that, bid you adieu. Enough of that. Are you still there?
We're still here. Yes. Thanks.
Unfortunately.
Well, thank you. Adrian asks, any special thoughts about cicadas?
I love them.
Yeah.
I actually seek them out, make special trips to go see them, not only in Indiana, but if I know of some in anywhere near where I'm traveling, we'll detour to go hear those periodical cicadas. I'm just fascinated by them, not only just their life cycle, but I think they're really cool looking creatures, and I love their sound. I guess it drives some people nuts, but not me. That serenades me.
So I am just stumped. This is supposed to be my first experience, and I have been so excited about it. And I'm up on the northern tip of Marion County, and I haven't seen them yet.
Yeah, they're pretty spotty when you get this far north.
Really?
You need to go south, go to the hills. Now, they're in some of our, you know, Turkey Run. If you went to Turkey Run, you'd hear and see a lot of them. But if you get down like from Morgan Monroe State Forest and south, you'll see them. I understand a fair number of people are hearing, and in fact, I heard a fairly large group of them over near Fort Harrison State Park. seems like Northeast Marion County has had a fair number of them, but they can be pretty spotty.
Yeah, Deborah said go to Fort Bend State Park. That's the same as Fort Harrison, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm on my way. Thank you both. And she said 56 and post. Yep. Okay, Deborah also asked, does Indiana have any old growth forests left?
Yes, and of course, you know, that's can be a moving target, what is referred to as old growth. Different people have different definitions of them. I never use the term virgin forest, but I do definitely use the term old growth forest. And I don't know that I have a specific age of tree to tag for it to be an old growth forest, but I'd say the dominant number in a site be 150 years, 130, 150 years, perhaps. And just the overall character of the forest too. To me, that is as, if not more important, looking at the species composition and not just tree size. But to answer her question, if she's looking for such places, go to the Indiana DNR Division of Nature Preserves website, and there's a directory, an online directory of nature preserves, and many of them will be identified as having old growth forests. You can go down in southern Indiana in Spring Mill State Park. There's one of my favorite old growth forests. It's called Donaldson's Woods. That's in Spring Mill State Park. That's quite an impressive forest. But, you know, Turkey Run, that Turkey Run not that far away, especially down in on some of the terraces, the floodplain terraces, have some just magnificent old growth patches of forest. So, yeah, they exist in Indiana. And some of them are as scrubby as you perhaps never think to imagine being old growth. On those really dry, rocky, poor soils, those trees that to someone interested in logs and boards would not be impressed, but they could be some of the very oldest trees in Indiana just because it's such a poor site and no one wanted them for much of anything. So they still persist.
Interesting. So Nancy's asking, isn't Meltzer Woods in Shelby County considered old growth?
I would.
Yeah?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Thanks, Nancy.
Certainly parts of it.
Okay. So Adrian thanks you and asks, can you speak to the impact of climate change you've seen over your career? Hmm. That seems rather large.
It does. And of course, you know, I've seen changes in things. I would say it certainly has a potential threat and concern to me, but I think I see more degradation of our natural communities by invasive exotic species, and of course, continued landscape alteration, whether it be clearing or development. I mean, there are just so many insults that have happened in our landscape. I haven't seen, for instance, there's talk about, you know, sugar maple is going to move north. But, you know, sugar maple is one of the trees that seem to be taking over our forests from the bottom of the state. So I don't know. I've seen some southern species move north. Most of them have propagules that allow them to be able to disperse easily. That is windborne, for instance. I've seen a few species normally thought of as more northern move south. Not as many as north, south to north, though. Yeah, it's hard to say. It's really hard to say. I've been here about 40 years now, and looking at the landscape, and invasives really concern me right now, immediately more than anything. I have seen proliferation of them over 40 years like you wouldn't believe. And that's a concern, big concern.
Understood. Greg asks, are there any restoration efforts for Short's goldenrod at Falls of the Ohio?
An attempt was made. I was involved with it. This could have been, 25 years ago or more. We tried to place some that were of Kentucky origin because we had not yet found the Indiana site, natural site, and placed them in a habitat that we thought was how had been described where they occurred historically. And there was that very winter, a flooding event that lasted weeks, and those plants never had a chance. They were underwater for so long and on into the spring that none of them survived. So I don't know that anything's been tried since, but it may be possible.
So it does make sense to you that might be tried in the future at some point?
Well, yeah, I think my philosophy is, some people call me a purist, but I don't like to see species put in places where they were never known historically, especially rare species. And there are a number of reasons for that. But I think given that was a site that from where it was known, that seems reasonable. But I wouldn't propose spreading seeds around or plants around of Short's goldenrod here and there just because we think that's what needs to be done to protect the species. I mean, it's as it turns out, the species is not difficult to grow. You can grow them, and several botanical gardens have them in seed banks and so forth. So anyway, I think Falls of the Ohio is a perfect place.
Interesting. Judith asks, are there any species of forbs that are only found in old growth forests?
I cannot think of any. Not certainly here in Indiana. There may be elsewhere, but no, I don't think there are that are just obligate old growth forest plants.
Okay. Adrian thanks you for answering her questions. And she also asks, how does one find the historical resources you used in your presentation? Are they online, or does one need to go to the Indiana State Library or some other archive, the surveys?
The survey notes, the state archives, they do have them. They're available to the public on microfilm. You'd have to go there to look at them. And they're not in the state library. They used to be archives, state archives did. Now they're out in a separate building near Shadeland on the east side of Indianapolis. Several universities, however, have copies of those microfilm rolls, and they can be viewed there. I suspect someday they'll be available online, but currently I'm not aware that they are. But they are a treasure trove of information. There is nothing that can stand up to the detail that they provide on the ground. You can like I say, you can go to the very spot where they were and read what they had to say. I once went to a spot where there was described a passenger pigeon roost, which, you know, a species that's extinct, no longer exists, used to be here by the billions. And they described this passenger pigeon roost that they said they had killed all the trees everywhere in sight, just by the mass numbers of. And so that, you know, that's the kind of really cool information you can get to be able to go to a very spot like that. I have a big sinkhole that I would never have seen had I not encountered notes in the survey notes about, they described it. Their line ran into it. And they said, well, here's a big sinkhole. And it was pretty impressive.
That's very cool. Out in the Pacific Northwest at the University of Washington, there was a grad student whose thesis was pulling together all of the survey notes and mapping them for like the whole King County. But so I don't know, maybe we should get some graduate students on it.
Yeah.
That is cool stuff. That's amazing history.
It is.
So Greg asked, can you tell us about your new book?
Oh, well, I just, you'd mentioned, I think, in the introduction, that's in press, which it is, but it's still early in press. Scott Namestnik, who's co-authoring this, and I now have in our hands the copy editor's notes and corrections, additions, and so forth that we are to return. And hopefully in a matter of at least months that it might be in print. It's called Wildflowers of the Midwest. It includes 8 states in the Midwest, from Minnesota, Northwest, over to Ohio, Southwest to Missouri, and all the states in between. And there'll be 1,100 species that are treated, each with descriptions and photos and so forth. So it's a photographic guide for the most part, but it does have written descriptions, but it's intended to be useful to beginning wildflower enthusiasts and botanists, as well as has some information hopefully of use to more seasoned botanists.
That's exciting.
Yeah, we're eager. Scott and I are eager to have it done, let me say.
Okay, I hear you. Is there a ETA on that yet?
No. In their review, their edits, they have the copyright is for 2022, so it won't be before then. I don't think so. Hopefully it'll be early 2022.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thanks, Mike. Well, that's the end of the questions in the chat right now. If anybody has anything else, if anybody wants to unmute, turn your video on, jump in. Adrian is back with another comment. I found Gene Stratton Porter's fiction and nonfiction helpful when visiting nature preserves in the Limberlost region and other historic sites associated with her life and her work. Are there other fiction authors that you suggest?
Oh, certainly I can't think of anyone, or if there is, forgive me, but in Indiana, I can't think of anything. You know, there's definitely some good books. If you're really interested in learning about natural history of Indiana, there's the Natural Heritage of Indiana, which is a big coffee table book edited by the late Dr. Marion Jackson. And that's a treasure trove. It's very readable, but it's also basically a textbook worth of of information about all aspects of Indiana, from flora, fauna, geology, weather, you name it. I'd surely, definitely recommend that.
Can you repeat that name? I'm going to throw it in the chat real quick.
It's called The Natural Heritage of Indiana, and Marion Jackson is the editor. Lots of different contributors. He was the editor.
Marion Jackson?
Uh-huh. He's a now deceased, but he was a professor at Indiana State University.
My mom gave me that book. It has this great quote on the
floor. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing.
He's a good one for that.
Yeah. To what extent has satellite data been of use during your career, like NASA satellites? That's from Adrian again.
That's not something that, I used aerial photos, but not something, from a satellite so much. But technology is amazing what's available now and different ways of imaging the landscape and what can be discerned in the landscape. I'm old school, I have to admit that. I looked at older aerial photos, to me, were more fascinating than the newer ones, because I could see the extent of disturbance or non-disturbance at a time where maybe disturbance in Indiana was at its zenith. There are aerial photos that go back to the 1930s, and you would be shocked to look at those photos and compare them to today, and you might be thinking you're looking at a forest that, hey, this has always been forest. Not necessarily so, and it may look pretty good to you. One thing we've been able to do, though, over the years, just from experience, is most of us in the business of doing assessment, natural areas assessment, can usually tell whether a site had been cleared 70 years ago, but now in forest, we can still tell that sort of a condition existed that long ago, just by looking at the composition of the plants that are there. So those older photos, which are at the archives again, just like those old notes, those are the things that I really, really valued.
Yeah, that is a treasure, isn't it? Any more questions for Mike while we still have them? Adrian appreciates your old school.
Yeah, good.
So Wesley has put a link into the chat here. It's a century past. So Wesley, I'm guessing that's aerials. centurypast.org, Great Lake States, Great Lake Fiction. I'll get back to my Zoom. Again, Mike, thank you so much. We appreciate all the time and effort that you put into bringing us these great presentations.
Well, certainly been my pleasure. I appreciate all of your attention and interest, and I'm happy to do it. It's a fun thing. I'm retired now, so gives me something to do.